instructions before an early basic instructions before an early basic instructions before an early.
Life is a test, many quests to universe, and through my research I felt the joy and the hurt. The first shall be last and the last shall be first. The basic instructions before leaving earth. Life is a test, many quests to universe, and through my research I felt the joy and the hurt. The first shall be last and the last shall be first. The basic instructions before leaving.
Knowledge is wisdom. This goes back when I was 12. I loved doing right, but I was trapped in hell. Had mad ideas, sad eyes and tears, years of fears, but yo, my foes couldn't bear. I searched for the truth since my youth, and went to church since birth, but it wasn't worth the loot that I was paying, plus the praying. I didn't like staying, cause of busy bodies and dizzy hotties that the preacher had souped up. The lies have cooped up, looking at loot button thighs. During the service, he swallowed up the poor, and after they heard this, they wallowed on the floor. But I ignored and explored my history that was untold, and watched mysteries unfold, and dropped the jewel like Solomon, but never follow men, cause if you do, your brain is more hollow than space oblivia, or the abyss, with no trace of trivia, left with the hiss. Does it pay to be deaf, dumb, blind? From a slave, he was kept from the mind, and from the caves, he crept from behind, and what he gave was a sect of the swine. When the Bible, it condemns the pig. I don't mean to pull your hems or flip your wigs, but we used to wear a turban, but now we're in the urban. No more wearing beanies or dressed like a genie. No hocus pocus, cause I focus on the facts and put it on the tracks and put it through the wax. I speak on Jacob, it might take up some time, and too much knowledge, it might break up the rhyme. I did it anyway just to wake up the mind of those who kiss stones or praise on the carpet. Those who sit home or sell books by the market need to chill and get their mind revived. For years, religion did nothing but divide. The basic instructions before leaving earth.
Life is a test, many quests to universe, and through my research I felt the joy and the hurt. The first shall be last and the last shall be first. The basic instructions before leaving earth. Life is a test, many quests to universe, and through my research I felt the joy and the hurt. The first shall be last and the last shall be first. The basic instructions before leaving earth.
I strolled through the books of Job to unfold and open Bibles instead of hoping on revivals. Calling on his name and screaming hallelujah. When he hallelujah, that's how the devil fooled ya. See, look into my eyes, brethren, that's the lies of a reverend. Why should you die to go to heaven? The earth is already in space. The Bible I embrace, a difficult task I had to take. I studied till my eyes were swollen, and only arose when I found out that we were the chosen. I deal with the truth and build with the youth, and teach my son as he kneels on the stoop. Son, life is a pool of sin, corrupted with foolish men and women with wicked minds who build picket signs. The legalized abortion, the evil eye extortion. I quit, son, with my wisdom. Before I converted, I was perverted, and knowledge was asserted. The study of wisdom, I preferred it. The understanding, it gave me mental freedom. I even learned Caucasian, but really, the tribe of Edom. The white image of Christ is really Caesar Borgia. And the second son of Pope Alexander, the sixth of Rome. And once the picture was shown, that's how the devils tricked my dome. I prophesied to save a man, but no one gave a damn. From my nation, the seed of Abraham. Blessed with the tongue of Hebrew. Now we strung on needles, and some are plunging evil. So study and be wise in these days of darkness. Peace to my nephew Marcus.
The basic instructions before leaving earth. Life is a test, many quests to universe. And through my research, I felt the joy and the hurt. The first shall be last, and the last shall be first. The basic instructions before leaving earth. Life is a test, many quests to universe. And through my research, I felt the joy and the hurt.
Greetings, everyone. We are here in another discussion with Dr. Scribina, but it seems that the tempo of the discussions have changed at this time because we're shifting topics from the metaphysics of technology to talking about the Jesus Hoax, another work by Dr. Scribina that explains the origins of Western culture or Western thinking, I think, in an oddly unique way, and one that was really discovered by Nietzsche in his Antichrist in sections 58 through 60. Me and Dr. Scribina have had many interesting discussions about religion, primarily because I was raised a Muslim, but Dr. Scribina has since I've met him, ascribed to Spinozistic sort of pantheism, which is a sort of naturalistic monism, but then also combines the elements of panpsychism and some of the great thinkers of the West. And really, Dr. Scribina has combined these viewpoints within a book he compiled entitled Panpsychism in the West. And he talks about the origins of Greek thought and other things. And we actually went to Greece one time, and we stood on the Areopagus rock. And it was there when Dr. Scribina had informed me that that this was one of the most monumental places in history, because St. Paul had spoken on this very rock and given a speech, in a famous speech that he gave in Athens, and this seemed to have changed the direction of both Greek and Roman and European learning to a considerable extent. The speech that Paul gave, and he also informed me that Paul is sort of a deceiver in a way, and I was not ready to believe him at this early stage, because I had heard the opposite in many religious forums, and I thought, man, that can't really be true, can it? But as I investigated, when he gave me a copy of the Jesus Hoax, I was startled to find the antagonism thesis in nearly every explanation of Christian teaching. So much so that I wrote I started to write about it myself, and I'll tell you guys about that later, but for now I would like to ask Dr. Scribina, is the God of the Jews the same as the God of Plato or the God of Western philosophy? What do you think about that?
Well, let's see. Yeah, I mean, so I think they had different origins because the philosophers were sort of working in their own circle. If we go back to, say, 500 BC, so they were working in a circle, and they sort of came across, or at least their version of monism, right? They came with the pre-Socratics. And we don't know where that came from. It may have come from the Middle East. It may have come from Akhenaten. We don't know, who was much older. And, of course, we don't know where the Jews got their idea of monotheism. There seems to be like they were actually not even monotheists early on, and they sort of changed to monotheism at some point. So they sort of evolved their own image. But, you know, I guess I would say that the Jewish God is the God of the Jews. I mean, he is a Jew. He's there for the Jews. He's the ultra Jew, and he's there to protect the Jewish people. That's what they did. They invented a God for their people. I guess this is natural. And probably the philosophers created a philosophical God, a monistic concept, a kind of a rational being, this logos being. I mean, that makes sense because that fit the Greek mindset. So the people create the gods sort of in their own image that's appropriate to those people. So the Jews, as sort of self-interested tribal entity, created a tribal sort of god, a tribalistic god, and the Jews, the Greeks, created a philosophical, monistic kind of god. Now, there was some overlap because you had one god and one sort of logos quantity, and they So you can imagine them mixing and one using the other at some point, but I think probably originally they were relatively distinct, I would say.
Yes, it seems that the god of the philosophers is not the god of theism. And the god of the philosophers, for one, you mentioned that the god of the philosophers is impersonal, has an impersonal nature. And then you seem to outline how this deism and pantheism kind of evolves through history in your panpsychism in the West. And we don't hear much mention of monotheistic elements in this evolution. So you've presented it there in quite a basic format for anyone who's interested. They can go look at what your points on that are. But also, it seems that you do not subscribe to a position of methodological atheism. Is that for the most part true? Because I know in our many discussions, we have tackled issues of science, and we've also tackled issues where science doesn't quite meet the full criteria or the full range of human capacity, and then we need philosophy to come in and kind of do something, such as in philosophy of science or philosophy of mind.
Exactly. Yeah, I mean, right, so I'm not following any traditional religion, but I don't call myself an atheist either, so it's something in between, right? So, yeah, I tend to take either a pantheistic view or sometimes a polytheistic view. It's all within a panpsychist framework. So that's, you know, to me, that's not really a religious outlook. It's not really a theological outlook. It's sort of a, let's say, a kind of a spiritual outlook on the universe, I would say, in some sense. So, yeah, I mean, to me, that's the common sense approach. I mean, science doesn't want to talk about this because science is dealing with objective materialistic reality,
right,
which can't even explain the human mind or consciousness, let alone larger spiritual or conscious type entities. So science at best has a sort of a half story, a half picture on reality, and it is absolutely insufficient to describe the total of reality. So you certainly need something else. You need a metaphysical component to go beyond the physical aspect of reality to talk about consciousness and mind and spirit and these kind of things. So science absolutely will not do the job. It definitely needs something beyond that, some kind of philosophical or metaphysical outlook.
Yes, I would most likely agree with those statements. but one of the ways that secularism or Western learning, I seem to conflate the two, although there may be some distinction there. But in terms of Western learning, it seems that the Jews in first century had placed themselves in a kind of a unique position with the Hellenization of the Jews. You kind of mentioned this in your book on page 33. And it seems like that the Jews had received, in some senses, a classical Greek education. And how would this assist in constructing a hoax?
Well, right. So you have to know a little bit of the history, right? The Roman Empire is expanding as Greece, classical Greece, is declining. So the Romans move in, they absorb Greece into the Roman Empire, and they absorb the Greek outlook because they know the great accomplishments. They absorb the Greek ethos, the Greek value system. They integrate it into their own. It becomes part of theirs. So it's sort of a joint Roman, Greco-Roman worldview, if you will. And then the Romans use that to their advantage, and they continue to expand. They expand to the Eastern Mediterranean. They move into Palestine, into Judea in 63 BC. And of course, they bring with them this Greco-Roman worldview, metaphysical view of reality. And then it runs into the Jews, who really had no exposure to that worldview until then. And then, of course, that becomes the model for learning, because the Romans were dominant as part of the Roman Empire. The Romans held Palestine for something like 400 years, right?
From
63 BC till what, mid 300s. So I mean, 4 centuries. So that worldview
is that until Julian the Apostate or something like that?
I forget his timing, but yeah. Something like that. But yeah, absolutely. I mean, that would have caused the conflict between the Jews and a Greek outlook. So it was through the interaction with the Roman Empire that brought with them the Greek mindset that the educated Jews would have become Hellenized in a sense and familiarized themselves with that particular worldview. Of course, they did not like it. That was the other problem. They saw these people as invaders, pagans or heathens, because they didn't buy into the Jewish mindset. They had a polytheistic view, which both Greek and Romans had. So there was basic conflicts. And then, of course, the main thing is that the Romans were military imperialists who took over Palestine, threw the Jews out of power, and took charge. So the Jews, of course, would have hated that. They hated because they were thrown out of power. They hated these pagans, heathens coming in and taking over and, you know, desecrating the temples and the whole thing. So there is no doubt that the elite Jews hated the Romans, and they hated the Roman worldview, and they probably hated the Greek worldview because they were generally hating of all other people, all other worldviews. This is a typical Jewish trait for thousands of years. But they had a double reason to hate the Greco-Roman view, because these guys were invaders who threw them out of power. And that was from 63 BC. So you can imagine over those subsequent decades that the Jews are thinking about how to get back, how to get back at Rome, how to strike back, how to subvert the enemy, how to kill the enemy. What can we do against these invading Europeans, the Greeks and the Romans at that point? And they want to strike back. So you can imagine there's various strategies. There is military strategy, and there's subterfuge, and there's attacks on the Roman centurions, and there's various attempts to do things, most of which were going to fail because the Roman Empire was far too strong. But that set the stage for people like Jesus of Nazareth, who would come along and be a preacher on behalf of the poor, oppressed Jews. And then later for Paul to come along and to develop his ideology to get back at the Romans from an ideological standpoint.
Yes, it does seem like the Jews seem to have seen an advantage in picking up Greek and Roman learning and using it to their own advantage. Some of the thinkers that I think are very clearly make this case are Philo of Alexandria, who around 33 AD was writing about all sorts of metaphorical aspects of the Jewish law, such as the forbidding of eating of pigs. He would say, well, that's just saying don't be like a pig instead of eating the pigs. And so you could see how this is kind of, maybe linked to Paul's views of the circumcision of the heart, and different tactics that Paul would use to convert the Gentiles and bring them into the Jewish covenant, which he explicitly states is his mission in Romans 9. But we also see other cases like Origen, who went to the same school. I found out that Origen went to the same school as Plotinus. He was like Plotinus's classmate.
sitting right side by side.
Yeah. And they were taught by a guy named Ammonius Saccas, who was a Neoplatonist, an African, and it's highly strange for many of the Christian thinkers, the proto-Christian thinkers, to have received this Hellenistic education, just as Justin Martyr did. And also, we see Eusebius saying that Moses that Plato and Moses are like the same guy. he says that the law of Plato, and he actually compares the Phaedrus to the teachings of St. Paul, and these kinds of weird ideas, So they seem to be considerably influenced. So you have Philo in the first century, you have Origen in the second century, you have Eusebius in the third century, and then finally you have Josephus, who's captured by Romans and used as an early source. And can we trust Josephus, Dr. Scribina? What do you think?
Trust him. Yeah. A converted Jew who sold out his fellow Jews, worked for the Romans for pay. And for
yeah. So, yeah, it seems like...
yeah, right. So he's obviously writing from a biased Jewish perspective, yeah. Whatever he says.
Right.
But, it's hard to tell, because I'm sure there are things that are factual in what he writes. You know, he wrote extensively, a couple of major works. So it's probably a blend of some factual information and then interpretations from a Jewish standpoint and then probably self-serving information on behalf of the Roman Empire. So, yeah, hard to say.
And it seems like we don't have to necessarily look to Josephus to see to find a secondhand source that talks about it, because all we have is secondhand sources. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are some examples of secondhand sources that Mark and Luke don't seem to have any firsthand account of Jesus and his ministry, even according to Christians' own understanding of events. And it seems that nobody even knows who John is.
Well, that's right. I mean, some people say maybe John was the Apostle John, I suppose. but I mean, okay, John is a generic name, right? Okay, thousands of people had the name of John. So you can't just say John and say, well, that's the same guy. The problem is all these documents, they came decades after Jesus supposedly lived and died, right? The letters from Paul, the earliest letters from Paul are dated about 50, and they run until about the year 70. The Gospels don't, the earliest Gospel was Mark, that doesn't come until 70. You have Matthew and Luke who come in the mid-80s and John in the mid-90s. So these are like decades, you know, 5-6 decades after the crucifixion. So we don't know who these people were, what they knew. They almost certainly did not know Jesus. They weren't alive at the time. They're hearing stories or writing something down out of whole cloth. There's many problems with the chronology, right, of both the letters and with the Gospels. It's a big mess.
And then we have, people like Luke, who are, Luke is Paul's secretary, that Paul mentions in his letters as his secretary, and then, it seems like, how could a student of Paul who didn't even know Jesus tell us firsthand accounts, and then his gospel is written in a firsthand account, and the other ones aren't? They're sounding like they're coming from some mysterious folktale, and then John is 90% different than the other gospels. So it just goes to ask.
I mean, they have exact quotations, right? The Gospels have exact quotations of Jesus. You don't see that in Paul, right? You look at all the letters of Paul, he never quotes Jesus, which is actually interesting in itself. It's clear that Paul had really no idea of what this Jesus said, because he never met him. He never heard him. He didn't even quote him once. I mean, that's like hard to believe. Of course, the Gospels do quote Jesus. They quote him exactly, just like they were... They had a transcript, or they were watching a video of Jesus talking.
That's right.
And this is decades afterwards. So how could you give an exact quotation of a guy, the Sermon on the Mount and all these, you know, the Last Supper? How could they possibly have given exact quotations of what he said when they weren't there, and it was 5 decades after, with no recording capability of what would have been said? So, yeah, it all lends this to the idea that it was a construction or based on vague rumors or... obscure ideas that were passed down from person to person. It's a terribly messed up, complicated history of how they could even have gotten to the point to write these Gospels.
Yes, and it seems that there's not a clear breakaway between what elements are Jewish and what elements are distinctly Christian. And that seems to be one of the main issues in the beginning, that there not only seems to be certain disagreements over what extent a Christian is a Jew, but also how the salvation of Israel plays into the salvation of the Christian, which Paul makes rather explicit that salvation will actually not come about until the full spectrum of Gentiles is like brought into the the four, and
Israel will not be saved until the full full right, the full sweep of Gentiles is brought under the church or something, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, it's clear. This is for the benefit of Israel. It's for the benefit of Jews. We need to convert all the Gentiles to our worldview, to our Jewish God, to our Jewish Savior, Jesus, to our, you know, Jewish worldview. And then Israel will be saved. I mean, he says it almost explicitly in the letters. So, I mean, it's very clear. You have to just take him at his word.
And Paul seems to refer to himself as a Jew by birth. He seems to set up in Romans that Jesus is a Jew by virtue of his descent from King David. So he seems to set up a genetic, a sort of a racial category that is unique and Jewish, as he says, you know, I'm a proud Pharisee, I'm from the tribe of Benjamin, and he's kind of setting up this Jewish identity, which is quite strange at the time, because he also seems to be kind of breaking away from that. And it's important to note, as you do in your book, that the term Jew actually refers to distinct aspects of an individual. One aspect is race or ethnicity, which many, like Barry Weiss, you know, they claim that they're Jews, they're cultural Jews, and that the cultural aspect of their Judaism is more important than their religious Judaism.
Right.
And so the claim has been made that one could be uniquely ethnically Jewish in one capacity, but also at the time it seems like the term Judaism refers to a religious category. So there's a lot of confusion there.
Yeah. Well, of course, originally it was basically an overlap. The Jews were a genetic ethnicity, which was a genetic subunit of humanity, and those Jews believed in Judaism. That was their worldview, their religion, and their belief system. So it was basically an overlap. The Jews were Judaic, so you didn't really need to distinguish those. And it was only later that you got this idea that you could be a non-ethnic Jew who believed in the Jewish religion, and then you had to make a distinction between the two. So they knew even back then, even Paul and those guys knew that Jews were, they didn't know about genetics, they didn't really know about race, but they knew that there was a group of people who were similar in some physical way, and that they needed to draw the Arabs and the pagans into their circle to get them away from the Romans. They couldn't make them part of their tribe because they were a different sort of people, a different ethnicity, but they could create a new belief system that was Jewish-like or Jewishly oriented that would serve the purpose. And so I think that's what Paul is dealing with. He wants to make the masses sort of sympathetic and draw them into a Jewish outlook. It's going to be detrimental to them, but he doesn't care. He just wants to pull them in, get them away from the Roman outlook. He can't make them Jews. He doesn't want to make them Jews, but that's okay. He's got to deal with his fellow Jews on the one hand, but he wants to sort of convert the masses to this Jewish-friendly, anti-Roman outlook, right? And that's part of this, the hoax thesis, right? That's what Paul was doing.
So Paul never knew Jesus, as you mentioned. He belonged to an elite class of Jews. And also, he changed his name from Saul to the Romanized Paul. and one could only guess at why he did all these things.
Yeah, well, it happened a lot. I mean, even today, Jews change their name all the time to sound less Jewish, to make them more accessible to the non-Jewish masses, right? So that's a very old story. They've been doing that for at least 2,000 years. Obviously, Paul wants to sound like he's accessible and approachable from the non-Jewish masses, which is his target. He says he's the apostle to the Gentiles. That's what his mission. So he's got to change his name. He's got to change his image to match his crowd. And he's going to pitch his message to his crowd. And he's going to change his own identity, right, to accomplish his goal.
Yes, it seems that all four Gospels refer to the Old Testament. But when we compare, as you say, on page 41 to 42 almost, in your book, you say, compare James and Peter and the first two Gospels with with a later anti-Jewish tone. So I think this is a pretty salient point, because it seems like the message becomes more anti-Jewish over time. And this is big time evidence for a hoax, because how could because it perfectly goes with the narrative of Paul trying to spread it, accomplishing him spreading the message to the Gentiles. And now they have to take this anti-Jewish tone. And
well, right, because the masses were anti-Jewish. They didn't like the Jews. Nobody liked the Jews. There's a long history of people who just did not like dealing with the Jews. So, yes, on the one hand, you want to sound anti-Jewish to appeal to the masses. On the other hand, Paul did have a real conflict with his fellow Jews, because he's out here pitching a distorted ideology in their view. He's telling them that this Jesus was the Messiah who came to earth, and the rest of the Orthodox Jews are saying, no, the Messiah has not come yet. So there's theological points of dispute. You can imagine there's strategic points of dispute where they're not liking his strategy. So Paul is getting flack from his Jewish side. So and his fellow writers, whoever wrote the Gospel of John in particular, we don't know who that was, but presumably a follower of Paul. So he would have been getting flack from the Orthodox Jews. So he's opposed to them because they're trying to stop him. He's got to sound anti-Jewish because that meets his audience again. And that fits with the circumstances and with the strategy of the time.
Yeah, it is quite striking to how in the first in Matthew and Mark, you see Jesus calls a Gentile woman a dog. But then in Luke and John, he's going around healing the son of a centurion. He's doing all of these other things. He's talking to a lady at the well in Samaria. And there's all these tales about foreigners, you know, how foreigners are also as good as a Jew.
Suddenly later, Jesus becomes Gentile friendly.
Gentile friendly, yeah. It's shocking.
First he's not, but later, because the message has got to work for the Gentiles, now he's a Gentile friendly character. So now we create stories and miracles about Jesus working the miracles on the Gentiles. So yeah, that's part of the strategy. That's exactly what you would do if you're trying to sell this Jesus myth person to the masses. Yeah, you'd say, look, he's doing good things for the Gentiles too.
And as a result, you see the second and third century influence exerts the most non-Jewish influences on the Bible, including with Gnosticism and so on and so forth. They expand on Logos theology and Gnosticism and all of these emanation theology, and also you see the Talmud and other sources like the Kabbalah and stuff come later. So there's no resources that we can find in Jewish mysticism that could show us how that early change took place, as some scholars allege. But it seems that to be unique from Paul. And at the time, you see the oppositional attitude of the Jews towards Rome. And you talk a lot about this in your book.
That was the trigger event. Yeah. That was the trigger event. The Jews hated the Romans. They were going to try to get it back at the Romans. They were going to undermine the support and the mindset of the masses as a way to undercut Roman strength. So
yeah.
That was really what was going on.
Yeah, and we see this with Tacitus and other writers, where Tacitus kind of says, the Jews that Christians are. First of all, he says they're despised.
They're despicable. I mean, just as a Roman, he is disgusted by the Jews.
Yeah.
I mean, they're appalling. They're abominable. They're base. They're vice-ridden. I mean, yeah, he's got nothing but bad things to say about the Jews. So that's on a Roman level. And then he recognizes that the Christians at that point are still kind of mixed in with the Jews. He doesn't have good things to say about the Christians either, of course.
Yes, he says that a most mischievous superstition thus checked for a moment again broke out not only in Judea, the first source of the evil, but even in Rome. where all things hideous and shameful from every part of the world find their center and become popular. Well, it seems like Tacitus is not quite a fan of Rome either, about the multiculturalism of Rome. Yeah,
it's the multiculturalism, right? All the debris and the waste products of the empires flowing into Rome, which makes sense. And so he's appalled with that. He's appalled with the Jews and their aspects and their attitudes. And he doesn't like the Christians either, because they're rabble-rousing troublemakers who are opposing the Roman, Greco-Roman worldview. So yeah, he's got a lot of things to criticize, for sure.
Of course, that would be due to the expansionist attitude and the attitude of trade between all parts of the world. You kind of get stray influences and stuff coming in when you have such an expansionist attitude. And also, Rome was a republic, so that was a unique form of government that it did not share with Athens. That was kind of a small polis.
At first, for the early part, it was a republic, that's right.
Yeah. Yeah, so I think that the Romans talk bad about the Jews, but what do you think, Dr. Sabrina? I think the Bible talks bad about the Jews too. Does it not? You mentioned the case of the Seleucid king putting the saying that the Jews worshiped the statue of a golden bull. And this
golden calf or whatever. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, and this seems to be coming right out of the Bible, doesn't it? I mean, it seems like
yeah, well, that's right. That's part of the biblical story, right? About the Jews worshiping money and gold and power of money. So, I mean, that's an internal critique that goes back. Where does that show up? That's early in the Old Testament. I've heard exactly where that comes up, right? But that's an old Jewish
That's
story.
At the time of Moses.
Yeah,
where they
the
make
time of Moses, exactly. So he's condemning his own people, saying you guys are money grubbing, you know, lusters after gold and power, and you know, how dare you? Well, okay, that's not compatible with pretty much any religion, but you know. And I think there was even kind of a theory that there was sort of a struggle between the spiritual Jews and the materialistic Jews, and the spiritual ones ended up losing out in the end, right? And the materialistic ones created a god in their image, and then they ended up dominating Jewish culture ever since.
Yeah, it seems that the Jews are that God not only does Moses throw down his tablets and say and claim that the Jews have broken their covenant with God, but also when they murder the prophet Zechariah, in Zechariah 11:10, it says that God has broken his covenant with Israel. So I don't know how, while reading the Bible, one could still allege that the Jews have this special relationship, as the Jews themselves claim. Maybe they don't know how to read, or they don't understand their own history too well. We see Cicero complaining about the the power of the Jews.
Yeah, that was even so. Cicero was a Roman orator, right? So this is already back in 60. What was the year? 65 BC or something. Yeah, I mean, as soon as you run into the Jews, you run into problems. They're trying to manipulate you. They're using their power of their money to bribe and coerce people.
It says here in your book, in the year 59 BC, Cicero gave a speech now entitled Pro Flacco, that offered a defense of L. V. Flaccus, a Roman proprator in Asia. Flaccus was charged with embezzling Jewish gold destined for Jerusalem. Strikingly, Cicero begins by noting the power and influence of the Jews. He says, "You know what a big crowd it is, how they stick together, how influential they are in informal assemblies, so I will speak in a low voice." I mean, isn't Cicero the one who popularized the Republic of Plato? I mean, this guy's not small change, but he has to watch how he speaks.
Even he, a powerful legislator at the Roman peak of the Roman Republic, and you got to believe he's sort of poking fun. He's probably not serious. He's like, "Oh, I got to watch out for these Jews because they're gonna, you know." But still, it was obviously, even if he's poking fun, it was still something to be mentioned. I mean, it must have been significant or he wouldn't even brought the topic up. So clearly they were there. Clearly they were influential. And that was very early in the takeover. If that was 59 BC and the Romans had moved in 63 BC, so that was only 4 years difference, right? 4 years later, Cicero's always complaining about, oh, the Jews have reputations for, you know, they'll get back at you. And those guys are, you got to watch out. They're going to, you know, cause trouble. So it's really remarkable, actually.
For such a strong statement to come so early on is really quite shocking. And then you have some of the unique links of Paul to Herod, where he, in 1611, he says, he calls him his kinsman. He refers to Herod as his kinsman, confirming his link with the elite Jews. And then also he says that, he mentions Epaphroditus in one of his letters, who funded the writings of Josephus and others. So it seems like Paul seems to be in step with a certain class of Jewish society and the ones that would be most capable of organizing against Rome. The very same ones that Cicero seems to mention.
He was absolutely one of the elite. He was well educated. He knew his history. He had connections, as he admits. So yeah, he was in a position to pull some strings and to really pull off his hoax strategy.
And in a page of your book, you mentioned that such a attitude still exists, such a supremacist attitude still exists among some Jews who follow the messianic expectation, where it leads into an eschatology of national restoration. And there it's in Jerusalem Post on the 18th of October in 2010. Rabbi Yosef seems to have stated, Goyim, non-Jews, were born only to serve us. Without that, they have no place in the world, only to serve the people of Israel. They will work, they will plow, they will reap. We will sit like an effendi and eat.
Yeah, that's a classic Jewish supremacist attitude. I mean, it couldn't be blunter than that, right? So
yeah.
And so, yeah, this is a clearly an Orthodox view, and it's an implicit view. Even a lot of sort of, you know, secular or liberal Jews sort of have this mindset, the superiority mindset. Like, you know, we're the better people, and we're going to take charge, and the rest of the people are going to work for us. So, yeah, it's, you know, there's a religious context, there's a secular context, but it's still within this framework of sort of a Jewish supremacist mindset.
Yeah, you have rabbis claiming that the dwelling in the land outweighs all the commandments of the Torah. So that's good, because you don't have to follow that stuff until you establish Israel. So none of those laws that we like so much that are part of basic morality are even incumbent upon Jews, it seems like, until their nation is restored, in some views. And also you have the view of atheistic Jews like David Ben-Gurion, who said in Look magazine that a federated court of all the nations will be set up through Israel. and even he and then paradoxically quotes Isaiah as a source for that, which I thought you were an atheist. This is really strange, you know. One of our aspects of this theory comes from Friedrich Nietzsche, one of the greatest philosophers, I think, to live. A German philosopher who was highly critical of Christianity, its effects on Western learning, and even claimed that Christianity, in its secular scope, had even invented liberal values to a certain extent. But he writes in your book on page 90, you quote Nietzsche, his quote is really quite amazing. He says, Paul invented his own history of earliest Christianity, the savior type, the doctrine, the practice, the death, the meaning of death, even what came after death. Nothing remained untouched. Nothing remained even similar to the reality. Paul simply transposed the center of gravity of the whole existence after this existence in the lie of the, quote, resurrected Jesus at bottom, he had no use at all for the life of the Savior. He needed the death on the cross and a little more. So, this is really quite amazing. How do you think Nietzsche was the only one in history to discover that Paul was the inventor of Christianity? Truly unique message. And not only that, but that this had such a profound effect on the world.
Huh? Yeah. Well, there were some skeptics before Nietzsche, right? There were earlier critics who had challenged ideas about the literal truth of Christianity, and they thought maybe it was some mythology was in there. So there was an idea floating around that there was some kind of, mythological aspects of the Christian religion. So people were sort of questioning it. But I don't think anybody really pinpointed Paul like
That's
Nietzsche
right.
did, right? So he says, and it's important because he doesn't, at that time, 100 years ago, they did not really have the chronology laid out. They didn't know when the letters were written. They didn't really know when the Gospels were written. I don't think they had a good idea about how these things flowed through time like we have today. But it was clear that, you know, all the effort, the church building, the ideology came from Paul. It didn't really come from Jesus, who just had basic little sayings about, you know, love your neighbor and turn the other cheek and blessed are the meek. I mean, there's really not much of an ideology there if you look at the quotes of Jesus. But it's Paul who's pitching the story of the crucifixion and you're risen after death and you get to go to heaven if you believe and all this stuff. So that's why it's the afterlife, right? This is what Nietzsche's saying. Look, Paul took the value in this life where people live and he put it in the afterlife, which is sort of the most important thing because that's where you go to heaven and get to live with God. So this life really kind of sucks. It's sort of this miserable place of suffering and sin, and you just sort of need to be a good follower of Jesus and you get your reward in heaven, and then you have that for all eternity. So this is really what Nietzsche is complaining about, that completely warps the morality of the real world by placing all the value in the afterlife, right, in another world.
Yes, it seems that Paul presents a subversive and anarchistic tone in some of his letters. Especially, I think, the letter to Ephesians presents this in quite a bit, because he's always talking about the higher order of things, controlling the powers of this world. And that higher order, at least in this age, is a depreciating and corrupt order of things. But then in the coming age, it's an age of forgiveness and salvation. So within this sort of, he paints this dialectic between flesh and spirit, right, and between the law and future salvation, which seems to be not only a sort of a spatial dualism between this spiritual sensibility that's coming through time, but also this kind of law, that the law is of the flesh. The right. law is conflated with flesh. And this is the age of law. And the age that's to come is like a lawless, like you don't need the law in the age to come.
Well, yeah, you got to remember Paul has a dilemma, right? He's pitching a religion, an ideology of the afterlife. Mm. So he wants you to think and go about the afterlife, but he's still a liar. He's still a deceiver. And he still wants to get rid of the Romans. So he wants you to do in this life, I want you to oppose the Romans, to get back at them, to you know, either look down upon them or fight against them or battle, struggle against them, because they are the ruling power of the age. Hmm. And that's really what Paul wants. He doesn't really care about the people. He doesn't care about the afterlife. He probably doesn't even believe in the afterlife. He wants you to believe it. He wants others to believe it. And he really wants people to struggle against the powers of this world. And so this is why you see the mix, especially in Ephesians and some of these letters, you see very militaristic, rebellious, anarchistic language. Helmet of God and the sword of truth and all these kind of little things, right? Militaristic, oppositional kind of language to sort of get people psychologically oriented against Rome, to oppose the powers of this world, which is really what he wants. So you see those messages mixed in with this belief in the afterlife. So it's a strange balancing act that Paul has to do. He says, don't forget about the afterlife, because that's where your reward is. But by the way, in this life, you got to oppose the powers that be, because that's what we want. We Jews, we want to get back at those Romans. We want you to help us, because we can't do it alone. So we need you to fight the powers that be. And that's what you see, actually, in Paul's letters.
Yes, and then we have a sort of an eschatology also of national restoration within this theme of the kingdom of God, which is going to supplant the current law and the sinful age with the age of redemption and all of this stuff. But this won't occur, as he says in Romans 11, until all of the Gentiles come in. So it seems like something is hanging on that what it hangs on is that the Gentiles have to believe in the God of the Jews. And this is Paul turning a message of Roman power, taking the physical symbol of the cross, which we have here, right beside us. And we have one made of light and one made of paper. So we have spirit and flesh right here, as you all can see, you know. What it really is that Paul is becoming all things to all men. And this seems like one of his tactics that he uses to supplant the spiritual community or the people who are more into ethereal matters. He uses the philosophical and mystical side. And for the people who are more about the visceral and physical restoration, he's also talking about the Jew and his role in the coming salvation. And
yeah, just keep in mind there's a distinction between the letters of Paul, which we think he wrote some of them, and somebody, some other fraudster wrote half of them. Half of them are forged anyway. So there's a double hoax going on there. Right? So, yeah. But of course the Gospels, right? We got to remember the Gospels all came after Paul was dead.
That's right.
So
yeah.
Paul knew nothing about the Gospels. They didn't even appear till he was dead and gone. And they bring lots of things to the story. They try to flesh out Jesus, make him a real person. They put all the quotes in his mouth. They give him the Sermon on the Mount. So all that comes after Paul. So it's always helpful to keep in mind the Pauline piece, which comes first, then Paul dies, and then it's the gospel portion, which sort of tries to build on the message and promotes the subtle rebellion against the Romans. And that's all kind of built into the gospels, those writers who presumably were followers of Paul himself. So that's right.
Yeah, and it seems that Paul changes his story depending on who he's talking to, like how he we were reading in Acts, the three different conversions in Acts. And
three different versions of his famous conversion to Christianity in Acts. And right, it's almost like it depends on who he's talking to. Well, I'll tell you one version because I'm talking to a Jew, and I'll tell you a different version because I'm talking to the Gentile, and I'll tell another version to somebody else. Yeah, exactly.
But even knowing these differences, scholars like Erman tend to claim, and even saying that they can't reach 100% truth with their historical methods. They can only reach a probabilistic account of what happened in history. Yeah. Still, they allege that they know that that these were somehow different versions added, but that Paul is never to blame in any of this.
Well, that's right. That's the funny thing, right? They have all these inconsistencies and the militant talk, and they'll find every excuse under the sun to explain it away. They'll say, well, Paul was sick, or he was confused, or he was schizophrenic, or he was, you know, he was misled, or he was, you know, mentally ill. Every excuse except that he was a malicious liar who was doing this on purpose, gearing his story and constructing a lie, a hoax, for his own benefit. They never consider that possibility, and so they have to make up every excuse under the sun to explain all these things away. And the one thing that best explains it is he knew what he was doing. He was very smart. He was clever about it. He was creating a hoax for the benefit of the Jews, to get back at the Romans. That's the consistent story that explains all these various inconsistencies.
Yeah, I remember in How Jesus Became God, Erman spends a whole beginning of one chapter talking about how he had a Jewish girlfriend, and how he had to tell her politely that she was going to hell one day, and that it put a rift in their relationship, almost charging Christians with anti-Semitism in some strange sense. But then he paradoxically claims on page 133 of his book, Peter, Paul, and Mary Magdalene, that Paul converted the pagans to believe in the God of the Jews. To what end does he think Paul is doing this? I mean, if he's just doing this because he's earnest in his beliefs.
He's just a nice guy, and he wants you to believe in his God. What's the big deal, right? Yeah, sure. No, all right. You know, same with Robert Price, Bart Ehrman. They never considered the possibility that Paul was a malicious actor, that he knew what he was doing, that he was lying. They never even consider that possibility. So, and they'll make statements that are true. Yeah, of course, that's what Paul was doing. He was trying to convert the masses to the Jewish God. But why? They never explain why. What's the motive? Where's the motive for what Paul did in the gospel writers? They never give you a good motive. Even Richard Carrier doesn't give a good story about the motive for these guys. He admits that they committed fraud, but he doesn't explain why. Is it just, were they bored? Were they trying to sell books? No, that's ridiculous. They had a motive, a reason why, and it was to corrupt the masses and to get back at the Romans.
Yes, it seems that Price totally obfuscates from the fact that that Paul was even a real guy. He actually claims that it was Simon Magus, who I think there's even less information about Simon Magus than there is about Paul. And I think proving a myth, I mean, how does one exactly go back in history, use the historical method to prove a myth? Something that is unreal on this very
page. There's no evidence. How do you prove that?
Yeah, exactly. It's a highly dubious undertaking.
It's called proving a negative. It's hard to do anytime. It's hard to do in the current day to prove a negative, let alone 2,000 years ago when you have very little evidence and you have no good historical records and so forth. So, yeah, that's right. You're trying to prove a negative that's 2 millennia old.
Or Carrier's famous theory that he brought up in a William Lane Craig debate, where he alleges that Paul was a schizophrenic. How probable is this man?
Exactly. No, that's ridiculous. Right?
Yeah.
It's just another way of excusing the inconsistencies that you see in the letters and in the Gospels. You're excusing it to say, well, he was mentally ill, or he was confused, or he was under pressure, or whatever. Yeah. Or better yet, he was just lying. That's really the best explanation.
It seems like certain writers are more interested in pandering to either Christians or atheists or some sort of crowd. Yeah, Jews. Yeah, some sort of crowd. We know that there's a concerted effort to silence any criticism about the Jews. Hopefully, this video doesn't get taken down, as many other videos were taken down for mentioning critical stances on the power of the Jews that they wield today, especially through the State of Israel, but also through Christian Zionism, which seems to, they say most Zionists are actually not Jews, they're Christians.
Numerically, right, that's true.
Yeah.
Right. I mean, you know, you got to keep in mind, most of what we're talking about and what I talk about in the Jesus Hoax book is events 2,000 years ago. So, in a sense, you can separate that from what's going on today. So, we're being critical of the Jews at the time, and we're talking about Paul as a Jew who was constructing a hoax. But, okay, that was a couple of individuals who lived 2,000 years ago. So, you know, there's no reason to make a necessary connection between that and today. That's a separate question, and we would have to have a separate whole discussion. Maybe we can talk about one time on Jewish power today and the Jewish lobby and how they operate, right?
Yeah.
So there are some similarities, of course, but the critique at the moment that we've been talking about in the Jesus hoax is ancient history. So nobody today needs to get upset about it unless they don't want to hear about history. I mean, that's the thing, right?
Yes, it does strike me as a little odd that the current push to blame Rome, as Ehrman does, and even some of the thinkers like Atwill and Valiant do, it totally takes the blame off of Judaism.
It sides with Judaism. It sides with the Jews against the Romans.
Yes.
That's what they're doing. You take it an anti-Roman view.
Yeah.
Anybody who's taking an anti-Roman view is taking the Jewish side. That's buying into the Jewish angle. Absolutely.
Yeah, and I think that's pretty much all we have for all of you today. And thank you for joining us. And have a blessed day now. Thank you.
Thanks, Mama. Thanks for everything.
Senses, clutch, date, divinity, wouldn't fuck, touched, hazy, God, change, rush, floor, life, veins, head, pressure, senses, clutch, date, divinity, wouldn't fuck, touched, hazy, God, change, rush, floor, life. From a head full of pressure as the senses that I clutch. Made a date with divinity, but she wouldn't let me fuck. I got touched by a hazy shade of God, help me change. Caught a rush on the floor from the life in my veins. From a head full of pressure as the senses that I clutched. Made a date with divinity, but she wouldn't let me fuck. I got touched by a hazy shade of God, help me change. Caught a rush on the floor from the life in my veins. It goes one for the cannabis, and two for your Dianetics. Three for the reasoning, and four for those that try to get it. Five for your love, and six for the stress, and seven for the day that I climbed into this mess. From a head full of pressure, rest of senses that I clutch. I made a date with divinity, but she wouldn't let me fuck. And I got touched by a shader, help me, and caught a rush on the floor from the life in my